social stratification, the Kuznets curve, and some guiding questions. In this video today, we'll ask some questions to get you thinking for this unit on social stratification. We'll also look more in particular at the idea of the Kuznets curve and where social inequality has been historically and where it's going, we think, in the future. Interesting questions about social stratification. We should probably start out with a definition. A definition of social stratification from the textbook is a system by which society ranks categories of people in a hierarchy. Innate in the definition of a hierarchy, of course, is the idea of inequality. A lot of American students often ask the question about, or often raise up interesting points here about the idea of Americans, I suppose, founding values of a society of equality, of fairness. When we look at the economics, of course, of our society today, or even historically, there's always been a great degree of stratification. That's true of all societies. Since the birth of human civilization, there's always been stratification, but the degree to which societies have been stratified has varied and still is very varied today around the world. So today we'll look at a couple different questions and introduce a couple different ideas for you to help you in your studies by yourself. Some of the key questions when asking about this are, who decides, who has access to the best education, the best healthcare, living conditions, who goes to war, what kind of jobs do you have access to? A great story we like to bring up as sociologists is the story of that Titanic, of course, this great crash. Interesting in the architecture of the boat of the Titanic crossing the Atlantic, we have different classes, right? First class, second class, and working class at the bottom of the ship. Of course, different prices for the tickets, different access to different food and different space and all these sorts of things. What we found was when the ship went down, of course, who was able to leave the ship or escape the ship most easily? The rich people at the top would paid the most money, and people at the bottom, without packed into the bottom of the ship like cattle, very difficult to escape the ship. And of course, they had limited lifeboats as well. So it's a really interesting little brief look into history and some of the inequalities innate in hierarchy, right? In a class-based system. The idea of the Kuznets curve actually comes from economics. It's the idea that as technology advances the economy, inequality to a certain point becomes more stratified. Through agrarian societies and industrial societies, society becomes more stratified. Power is more centralized at the top or with the wealthy. But then after industrialization happens, we begin to see this trend reverse. And more people get access to better quality of life, more income. Human rights progress as well alongside the economy with political rights and all these sorts of things, living conditions and standards. And so we see this curve begin to reverse. It's overall a very good thing. And we've seen over the last 100 years, quality of life around the world dramatically increase. But what's interesting and troubling some sociologists and economists is this trend since the 1970s, where the Kuznets curve has actually been turning back upwards, where we're seeing more stratification. And they're talking about the shift from the industrial age society to a post-industrial age society, an information-based society, ones that we talk about today often in class or even in the media. And so we're seeing some interesting trends. Of course, we can't make any huge statement yet because we don't have a ton of data on it yet, right? We need to establish good research here. The history of this is quite interesting. If we look at going all the way back to, of course, one of the first law codes, the first most famous law codes, the Code of Hammurabi, was innately favoring the elites. The people with power had an easier payment system if they were to break a law than, for instance, a slave. During the Industrial Revolution, we saw, during the hunters and gatherers society, we know that humans had a very low impact on the ecology, on the environment. But as society began to become more industrialized, we see more and more cities being developed, urbanization happening, the nature of work drastically changing. This is where Karl Marx comes in with his alienation. Capitalism is alienation, and he sees this is where the damage really begins to happen. And this is, of course, when he develops his theory as well. We also see a great outpouring of literature and art at the time in reaction to these huge social changes. For instance, Charles Dickens, probably most famous for Oliver Twist, and, well, my personal favorite, A Christmas Carol, Christmas Story, I'm not sure which one, exposing or writing at least about some of what he saw as the social injustices around the world, or in his beloved London, young boys being forced to do chimney sweeping or machine work, or the state of orphanages in the city, and the pollution, in fact, a lot of was an interesting topic of many of his books. In painting as well, we see Rembrandt painting about corporate people, companies, right? Who could commission art? Of course, people with the money. That's always been the case up until very, very recently. In the second piece, we see a still life. These items here favored by the Dutch during the Dutch Golden Age. Huge economic boom happening there in the 17th century in the Netherlands. And they chose to paint items of worldly value. Items that were expensive, that were showing and demonstrating their class. I have money, I can afford to buy wine, I can afford to buy lobsters and cheese and fruits and imported goods. In fact, I can afford to pay somebody to paint this for me. There's a lot of symbolism going on here, but it's also very directly, explicitly, a demonstration of wealth. This is a concept in sociology called conspicuous consumption, where what you buy is supposed to be a demonstration of your social class. We see it around us today as well, with, for instance, the purchasing of expensive handbags or name brand cars, or wearing a particular fashion or perfume, going to a certain place, trying to identify or make a statement about your social class. Conspicuous consumption, great stuff, and I think very much alive here in China as well. The idea of media having an effect on people's attitudes is one of the central ideas in a lot of social critical theory, especially symbolic interactionism. How do the symbols, stories, and ideas come out into society to create meaning? And I just love this piece. It's called a genre painting, and it was about the same time period as the ones we were looking at in the 17th, 18th centuries there. And this one's kind of celebrating not the rich life, not wealth, but kind of the working class. The quietude of doing everyday tasks. And Marx, from a social critical theory, would say that this is the formation of an ideology. An ideology, our textbook has a definition. An ideology is defined as cultural beliefs that justify particular social arrangements, including patterns of inequality. So Marx would say, cultures, especially industrial and pre-industrial societies, capitalistic societies, seek to create ideologies through their myths and art and stories that reinforce patterns of inequality favoring the powerful. So of course he would say the capitalists are trying to create, glorify this everyday menial labor sort of thing so that people would be happy doing it. Interesting theory there. What we know about the Kuznets curve today, what we know about social inequality today, if we look at this graph, is interesting stuff. This graph shows different categories of income broken up into five different percentile groupings of 20%. What we see over the last 100 years or so is that more or less the bottom 60% of the population in the U.S.'s income has remained relatively stable. This is adjusted for inflation. The very bottom level, we see it's actually absolutely flatlined, and it increases slightly for those middle rungs. The orange group here, the upper middle class, slight raise since especially the 70s. But who's actually been receiving the greatest income or any of the increase in wealth? It's been the top percentile, and we're seeing that in fact this seems to be increasing over time. So, to use an old adage, the rich seem to be getting richer, and the data supports it. So it's interesting times and interesting issues. What does the changing nature of work today with the with technology we have, with the internet, with globalization, how does that affect our societies, our values? How does that change the way society has been heading for the last 150 years or so since the Industrial Revolution? According to Kuznets, we've experienced a great deal, and this is reinforced by other data, we've experienced a great leveling of quality of life, and that's beginning to change now. So what does that mean for the future, and what does it mean for us today even? Thank you.
The way you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea, the memory of all that. Changed my life.